Welcome to worship this fifth Sunday in the season of Epiphany. We acknowledge that this worship service is virtual and that we are not all gathered in one place. I therefore ask each of you to be responsible for giving thanks for the land where you are and to acknowledge its current treaty holders. The church building here rests on the land known for millennia as Mokinsis, where the Bow River meets the Elbow River in a place that we now commonly call the city of Calgary. This is the traditional homeland of the Métis Nation of Alberta Region 3 and the peoples of Treaty 7. These are the Nisitipi people, the Siksika, the Piikani, the Kainai, the Tsuut'ina, and the Îyâhe peoples, and the Nakota people, the Chiniki, Bearspaw, and Wesley First Nations. We continually acknowledge that we gather and meet on treaty land as a reminder both of the privilege we enjoy as a result of unjust current and historic systems and of the imperative to bring greater justice for a sustained and shared future. Come, let us worship. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. I invite you to join in the morning's dialogue by responding to the parts that are in bold. Jesus, the bright morning star, shines light in the world. By day and night, he shines for all to see. Jesus was born in the midst of injustice and poverty, that the world may see the justice and richness of God. God so loved the world that God sent Jesus so that all who believe in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Jesus is the light of the world.
Jesus
is the light of our lives. Sing to God a new song, a song of hope, joy, and peace around the world. Let us pray. Everlasting God, you give strength to the weak and power to the faint. Make us agents of your healing and wholeness, that your good news may be made known to the ends of your creation through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Our first reading is from the book of Isaiah, the 40th chapter. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told to you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth are nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth. When he blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me? Or who is my equal, says the Holy One? To whom then will you compare me? Or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see who created these. He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power. Not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus, Lord.
Our second reading is from 1 Corinthians. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews, I became as a Jew in order to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might by all means save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessings. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Give us strength to love each other.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the first chapter, verses 29 to 39. Glory to you, O Lord. As soon as Jesus and the disciples left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told Jesus about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and raised her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, Jesus got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring town so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. They certainly knew that she was sick. A fever in the days without our advances in modern medicine was a scary and dangerous thing. Simon and Andrew knew that she was sick. They knew that it was dangerous. They knew that she might die at any time. They were in an in-between time, in this middle space between being well and being dead, worried for her life, for the life of Simon Peter's mother-in-law. And what did they do? They went across the street and went to the synagogue. They did what they did every Sabbath day. They crossed the street from their house to the synagogue, and in the midst of the company of praying men, they studied the scripture. They reminded themselves of the goodness of God found in the word of the Lord. And what a good word it is this morning. Have you not heard? Don't you remember the good news of this great God? This God who spreads the heavens like a tent and prepares the ground for rain? This God who knows the fragility of the grasshoppers? In other words, don't you think this God of the vast universe, who is also near, knows what's going on across the street? This was their weekly routine. Don't you know that this God of the universe knows you haven't caught any fish this week? Don't you think God knows that there's a pandemic? Don't you think that the God who counts the stars and gives them names cares about you? We had a new gift of technology to our house at Christmas time. We bought our son Paul Alexa. That's right, the robotic woman who speaks on behalf of the internet entered our front door. And we have little devices all in all of our main rooms of our house now, and we can tell Alexa all sorts of things like turn on the lights, turn off the lights, turn on the TV, turn on the music. And sometimes when I lay down in my bed, I ask Alexa to tell me something I don't know about the universe, or to tell me, to sing me some lullaby. The other night I lay down and I said, "Alexa, how many stars are in our universe?" And Alexa said, "According to a consortium of scientists, it is estimated that there are 100 billion stars in our known universe." 100 billion. I lay in the dark picturing that canopy, or at least trying to, because I have no idea what 100 billion looks like, but just rounding down by quite a lot, that's 10 times the number of people on our planet. Much more than that, actually. Do you think that the God of our known universe and all the universes we don't know about, who spun 100 million planets, those are the ones we know about, and gave them each a name, doesn't know your name? That's the question of Psalm 147. In this middle, in-between time, for Simon and Andrew, they were in the synagogue studying such things with their friends and neighbors as they did every week when Jesus, on the first day of his public ministry, as we heard last week, came in and cast out an unclean spirit. Can you imagine these two guys? This is a new teaching with authority while we're studying the scriptures about our great God, and my mother-in-law is right across the street on her deathbed. What do you think they did next? They invited him to dinner. And of course, they crossed the street, and the rest is, as we say, history. One of my homiletics professors said that I should never bring up anything in a sermon that I can't resolve, and yet, here I go again. We're in such an in-between time. We're in such a middle place, somewhere between birth and death, somewhere between study and the accumulation of faith and wondering when this pandemic is going to end and how it's going to end and who else is going to fall victim to it. We are in this in-between place. So what is there for us to do? But the same thing that Simon and Andrew did every Sabbath day of their lives, and the same thing that we do every Sunday in our lives. We gather and we study and we pray and we give thanks and we worship our God. And this middle time, this in-between time between knowing what has begun and not knowing how it's going to end, this is actually the fertile ground for hope and for faith. Because if you know how things are going to turn out, that's not hope. That's certainty. Hope is looking into the future and believing the good news that you can't see yet. And faith isn't faith if you already have a solution. Faith is believing that goodness will come in spite of the evidence before us. And believing it so long and so hard that you keep believing until you watch that evidence change into that thing that you have hoped for. And if that doesn't describe the state of our world now, I don't know what does. Because even as we're on the cusp of having vaccines available for all the world's people, now we're dealing with variants that don't respond to the vaccine. I heard a news report in the United States this morning from Dr. Fauci, who said, "We are not giving out vaccines fast enough to keep up with the variants." And then he said this, "But we're getting better and better." Even wise old Dr. Fauci is keeping his eyes focused on that thing that he longs for, that he sees can be, and is speaking it to people. Even our scientists are hopeful and faithful. And this reminds me of how I started ministry, actually, as a much younger woman. I had occasion to enter federal prison for young women. They were between the ages of 14 and 24. And of course, these women are in prison due to their own actions, but also to horrific things that had been done to them by others. And one thing was for sure about their situation, and that was that they were alone and forgotten people. And sometimes I think about that, being alone and forgotten at age 15, 20, serving hard time for horrific things. And in this ministry, we used to go into the prison and teach them about forgiveness. Not that they should hope that the people they had done things to would forgive them, but that they themselves would develop the capacity to forgive the things that had been done to them, that then set a snowball of horrific things in motion. And this very psalm today, Psalm 147, was the foundation of our work together. And we would read to them, God builds up Jerusalem and gathers the outcasts of Israel. God heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. God determines the number of stars and gives to all of them their names. And then we would present them with a name tag for themselves in the shape of a star with their name on it. And throughout the course of that ministry, we reminded them that they are known and beloved of God. That even though it seems like they're alone, forgotten, and abandoned, it's actually not true. Day by day, we laid the fertile ground for them to see that hope and faith can only live in a space where we don't know what the outcome is. Hope and faith can only live in the backdrop of despair and lament, of tragedy and illness and sickness. I shouldn't bring up things I can't resolve. But Simon and Andrew went to the synagogue and they studied and prayed and they heard these same words. And they reminded themselves that they have seen and heard the word of a gracious God who is near, who loves and who cares. And then they saw that teaching with authority in that first public act of Jesus the Christ. They invited him to dinner. He crossed the street. They told him about Simon Peter's mother-in-law. He went into her immediately. He took her by the hand, and the scripture says he raised her up. The same verb that's used of the crucified Lord in chapter 16, which is coming at the end of this gospel, the angel standing in the tomb, and he says to the women, what are you doing here? Why are you looking for Jesus of Nazareth here? Don't look for him here. He has been raised up. He told me to tell you to meet him in Galilee, where you have seen wondrous things, meaning the casting out of that first unclean spirit and the lifting up of Peter's mother-in-law from a near-death fever. He's waiting for you there where it all started. So go, be on your way. Now, dear friends, is the season for hope. It's the season for faith. It's the time to remember that our God spun the planets and the stars, over 100 billion of them that we know of, and many, many billions, hundreds of billions more that we don't. And that our God gave to each of them a name. This is a season to remember that if God named the stars, God also named us. We live under that pitched canopy of the cosmos, God's most precious and beloved creation. And if we're wondering where God is now, where Jesus is now, where is this healing now, where is it for us? We have nothing to do but remember that he's in the synagogue and he's just about to cross the street. He's on his way. And he alone is our light and our hope. And in him we place our trust. Amen.
for truth, we turn to you. Make us your own, your holy people. Light for the world to see. Christ, be our light. Shine in our hearts. Shine through the darkness. Christ, be our light. Shine in your church gathered today. Longing for peace, our world is troubled. Longing for hope, many despair. Your word alone has power to save us. Make us your living stones. Christ, be our light. Shine in our hearts. Shine through the darkness. Christ, be our light. Shine in your church gathered today. Longing for food, many are hungry. Longing for water, many still thirst. Make us your bread, broken for others, shared until all are fed. Christ, be our light. Shine in our hearts. Shine through the darkness. Christ, be our light. Shine in your church gathered today. Longing for shelter, many are homeless. Longing for warmth, many are cold. Make us your building, sheltering others. Walls made of living stone. Christ, be our light. Shine in our hearts.
Let us profess our faith in the words of a creed of darkness and light. We believe in God, robed in splendor, veiled in mystery, ruler alike of darkness and light. We encounter God in Jesus Christ, who was tortured and put to death, but whose radiance could not be quenched. He revives the weary, heals the wounded, and dazzles the satisfied. We walk with God, guided by the light of God's loving Spirit, who enters the shadowed places of our hearts and leads us into truth and life. We wait for God and for the fulfillment of God's promises, for the time when the darkness will hold no fear and the light will no longer blind, but creation will be made whole once more and God's peace will reign forever. Amen. Guided by Christ made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. We pray for the church, for ministries of healing and wholeness, for hospital, hospice, and military chaplains, for those serving in prison ministry, and for all who proclaim freedom and release in the name of Christ. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For creation, for insects in the grass, clouds on the mountaintops, for cattle and the rainwater they drink, for the humility to take our place among all creatures of the earth, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For the nations, for all who lead in cities and towns, states and countries, for community organizers, school officials, and CEOs, for international health organizations, that in times of trial, fear, or hopelessness, they find freedom in service to those most in need. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For all who are wearied by life's burdens, for those who are poor, those who are lacking supportive relationships, for those crushed by debt, for those struggling with chronic pain or other sickness, for those exhausted by overwork or stress, and for all who cry out to you, especially those who ask us to pray, Gemma, Ray, Matt, Dave, Yvonne, Gil, and Elsie, Patrick, Lynn, and Jeff, Ella, Marlene, Edie, Deke, Dirk, Lorna, Sherry, Sheila and Jim, Bill and Ruth, Devona, Colin, Carter, Eric, and Zella, and all those who mourn, especially the Julin, Ian, and Wells families, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For this congregation, near and far, in our homes and in other places where we gather for worship, for outreach and social ministries centered for parish nurses and visitors, for ministries of companionship and support, for the young people in this place who open us to new understandings, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For what else do the people of God pray? We thank you, God, that you number and name the stars and that you heal up the wounds of our broken hearts and that you pray in that deep place within us where words have yet to form. For all for whom we pray, have mercy, O God. In thanksgiving for the faithful departed who were called by name and now rest from their labors, that their lives serve as a witness to the goodness of God, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior, Lord, and friend. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. This is normally a time that we collect the offering and gifts, but because of COVID, we are not passing the plate here. That wouldn't do much good. So at this time, we want to thank you for your continued generosity to the ministry of the church. And if you're worshiping online, to remind you that you may use the donate button on our website if you would like to give an offering. You can also find us listed in the list of charities in Canada Helps. And thank you again for your generosity and your faithfulness in giving. Hear now a musical offertory.
Let us pray. O God of justice and love, we give thanks to you that you illumine our way through life with the words of your Son. Give us the light we need. Awaken us to the needs of others. And at the end, bring all the world to your feast through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. A couple of reminders. At 11 a.m., we'll be gathering in the prayer Zoom room for Holy Communion, and then after that, some fellowship time, and then 11:30, transitioning to sermon talkback time.
After prayerful deliberation, the Personnel Committee at Lutheran Church of the Cross has appointed Stacy Kotler to serve in the position of Office Administrator. So we invite Stacy forward to this place of consecration. We're going to come down there. Our Lord Jesus, who came among us as a servant, calls us to faith and a life of loving service to our neighbor. Stacy, you come among us as one invited to render a particular service, a gift from God to inspire us to love and to good works. In the presence of this assembly, seven of us here gathered beside you, and this assembly gathered virtually.
The multitude
gathered virtually. Will you commit yourself to this new trust and responsibility in the confidence that it comes from God?
I will, and I ask God to help me.
Will you carry out this ministry in accordance with the Holy Scriptures and with the confessions of the Lutheran Church, and in harmony with the constitutions of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in Canada?
I will, and I ask God to help me.
Will you be diligent in your study of Holy Scriptures and be faithful in your use of the means of grace and in prayer?
I will, and I ask God to help me.
Trusting in God's care, will you seek to grow in love for those you serve? Strive for excellence in your skills, and adorn the gospel of Jesus Christ with a godly life.
I will, and I ask God to help me.
Almighty God, who has given you the will to do these things, graciously give you the strength and the compassion to perform them. Amen.
People of God, will you receive Stacy into this ministry as one sent to serve in the Church of Jesus Christ? If so, respond, we will, and we ask God to help us.
We will, and we ask God to help us.
Will you pray for her, help and honor her for her work's sake, and in all things strive to live together in the peace and unity of Christ?
We will, and we ask God to help us.
Stacy, I now declare you installed as office administrator. Almighty God, bless you. And direct your days and your deeds in peace, that you may be a faithful servant of Christ. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, we remember with thanksgiving the orderliness of your creation and the preservation of life. Bless and accept Stacy's ministry in the stewardship of the resources entrusted to your church, its people and their talents, its wisdom and energy from your Spirit, and its wealth from your goodness. Remind us that we are accountable to you in all things, great and small. And as you called apostles and evangelists, pastors and teachers to instruct, comfort, admonish, and care for us, so too you have called Stacy. Fill her with wisdom and patience, with love and with faithfulness to your word, that she may with gladness teach, comfort, counsel, answer the phone, make copies, guide your people to maturity in Christ Jesus, your Son, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen.
We also have a token of the passing of the baton of office administrator to you, so we invite Diane Forte to come and say a few words.
Very few.
Very few.
Very few.
This is a way easier day today than last Thursday. And I'm just so happy and thrilled that you're taking this job, this ministry. And I think you saw a little bit last Thursday of the love that this congregation can pour out. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I thought of passing you the key, but we'd already given you a key to the door. So I give you the membership list, even though you've seen it before too. But this is the heart of this congregation. And my prayer is that they love and honor you in all the days of your work here. So,
thank you, Diane.
It's like a, well.
You're saying this now.
I'm saying this.
I'm holding it for you while you say it.
People of God, I present to you Stacy, your office administrator.
Yay! Everyone, jazz hands and clapping. Fantastic. Let us welcome Stacy in the name of Christ. And ordinarily, in worship when we have an installation, that welcome would continue with coffee, cake, and punch in the narthex, and that will come sometime, but probably several months from now, so you can look forward to that. And in the meantime, we invite you to call the church office and make her answer the phone. mostly because you deserve some of her sunshine and to get to know her, too. So we invite you to call and to begin conversation with Stacy. And now a blessing for us all. God the Creator, strengthen you. Jesus the Beloved, fill you. And the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, keep you in peace. Amen.
Amen.
Light of Christ.
Thanks be to God.